Assemblymember Haney, I want to get you to drill down on this constitutional amendment that you proposed. What was the catalyst for this? Was there a project that you were working on, a piece of legislation where you said, you know what, if we had a constitutional amendment, the right to housing in the California Constitution, this would not be happening?
Well, the housing crisis in California is completely out of control. It's impacting every single resident in our state, whether you're one of the almost one in two households who is housing cost burden, meaning you pay more in your rent, your mortgage than you can afford, or you're somebody who has folks who are living on your sidewalk or on the street in your neighborhood. California has 12% of the country's population, but half of the people who are unsheltered homeless. So our housing crisis in our state is completely out of control. And the pace at which our state and our local governments and our cities and counties are responding is not going to address this crisis. We are 2 million homes short to meet the needs of our population, near dead last in housing units per capita. And so we need something that's transformational, where we can truly hold every level of government accountable to deliver on what I think most Californians understand is a fundamental human right. You can't live without food, water, or shelter. And if you don't have a home, everything else in your life suffers, and our communities suffer, and our state suffers. And this, acknowledging it and codifying it in our Constitution would be transformational, and it would make a big difference and be a game changer.
All right, so let's talk about the difference in the game changer. So let's say this is on the 2024 ballot. I know it's working its way through the legislature right now. I also want to point out there's no formal opposition as we speak. So voters pass this. Let's say it's on the 2024 ballot, takes effect in January. What does that mean January 1? Does that mean, you know, housing projects that have been held up are greenlit? Does that give, you know, the opportunity for more litigation to, I know the governor has been suing cities like Huntington Beach. The attorney general has been proposing lawsuits up here in Northern California at Elk Grove because of halted housing projects. I mean, what specifically will this do to move the state in the right direction for all of the issues that you outlined?
Well, for one, is it communicates on behalf of the people of California that this is a right that every level of government needs to act on and provide a plan to actualize. It doesn't mean that everyone's going to get free housing from the government. It doesn't necessarily mean at all that the government will provide any more housing directly. But it does mean that every level of government, city, county, state, need to be providing plans and a strategy to actualize this right so that everybody can access equitable housing and affordable housing. Right now, we elevate abortion and contraception as fundamental rights, privacy, property, education, voting. A lot of things are recognized as fundamental rights, and housing needs to be elevated at that level. What it will mean in practice is that cities, counties, the state will need to be able to demonstrate a plan to make sure everybody can access housing. It's not just in how we fund and invest, but also in our zoning decisions, in making sure that places aren't restricting or banning housing from being built altogether. And it will mean that when governments make decisions, that and a court will look at it, maybe in conjunction with other laws that already exist, it will view this as something that Californians have communicated at the highest level in our Constitution as being a right that deserves the utmost respect and deference. And it makes a difference. It's something our courts are very familiar with. We've had a lot of conversation about the Second Amendment, the right to bear arms. That's something that our courts know how to do balancing tests around. And if you restrict it or you violate it, they look at it with more scrutiny. We have to take the same approach when it comes to housing. Otherwise, we're really just not going to get there as a state.
Some critics might say, "Yeah, this sounds like it's a bit more symbolic." What do you say to them?
There's probably nothing more powerful that we can do as citizens than codify a right in our Constitution. It means that every decision that government makes, this will be a factor that is weighed, either if it's challenged in court, if there's enforcement involved, and this one is actually a positive right in that governments will have to come forward with plans as to how they're going to meet this right. The reality is the status quo is entirely broken. I don't think any Californian believes that if we just allow government to go on as they are, that they're going to get this done, that they're going to solve homelessness, that they're going to reduce the cost of rent. We need to do something powerful and dramatic. And the way that the citizens can do that is to codify something in the Constitution and say, you have to act on this, you have to actualize this with your policies, and if you don't, you can be held accountable accordingly. And so this is a very powerful, not only a statement, but actually it has real teeth when it's brought into courts or when governments don't act on it.
All right, before I end this conversation, I want to ask you something a bit off topic here about the city of San Francisco, your district. It seems as though every week we're seeing more headlines, national headlines, too, about businesses leaving. I believe this past week it was the Hilton in Union Square and Park 55 have announced news that they are going to remove those properties from their portfolio. And it's been a couple of reasons that some of these businesses, the topic of theft and homelessness and crime, but also the business community has felt that there's uncertainty that San Francisco will be able to bounce back after the pandemic. A lot of folks who were in tech were working from home. They're not coming back to the city. So that's affecting the economy there. Does the city of San Francisco have an image problem? And how do you repair something like that?
Well, the city of San Francisco, I think, has an image problem and has real problems that need to be confronted and need to be solved. San Francisco was a place that really built itself and developed around dense commercial office space, particularly in the tech sector over the last 20 years. And that's the industry that has completely transformed. People are no longer coming into those big office spaces. They're working from home. And everything has changed about the way that people work. And that's hit San Francisco really hard. So that has hit San Francisco in combination with a lot of the things that are happening all over our state around homelessness, mental illness, public safety. And so San Francisco has to confront these issues, and also it has to adapt. You know, we have to attract new industries like climate technology or biotech and bring more hospitality, make it easier to open small businesses, make sure our city is safer and cleaner, and we address the mental illness. So there's image problems for sure, but I'm less worried about our image and more worried about the real problems that our residents are facing and how it impacts our whole state. Everybody in the state loves San Francisco. There's no California without San Francisco. It's a huge part of our economic and cultural success. And so we all need to be cheering and supporting San Francisco to get back on its feet. It really does affect the well-being of our entire state.
Are you confident that leaders are putting forth the effort and looking at this the right way? We know the governor had a meeting with some local businesses, local business leaders, members of the San Francisco Giants a couple of weeks ago. And to talk about, you know, you mentioned some of the topics there and the issues the city is facing right now. And the governor's office articulated this when they sent the release out, you know, to repair the image of the city. Do you feel like all the players are sort of coming together and this is something that can be fixed? I mean, what does the timeline look like?
Well, I'm, you know, as someone who's at the state level now, I really commend the governor and call on the governor and state leaders to step in and support San Francisco as well. There's a lot about local government and city government in San Francisco that has unfortunately been a part of the problem and pretty dysfunctional. And so for us to really step in where we can as state leaders, we've done this on housing, you know, getting rid of some of the barriers that exist to build housing in San Francisco. I have a bill to convert some of the office space to housing downtown and make sure that there aren't roadblocks locally to do that. So I do see people coming together and working together, but I do think that the state also has to step in because we can't allow San Francisco to continue to spiral. We need San Francisco to thrive. It's such an incredible place economically, culturally, socially, what it offers to our state and the world. And, you know, we do need everybody swimming in the right direction, in the same direction. But I do think the state leadership on law enforcement, on tourism, on investment, housing is going to make a difference.
All hands on deck approach. All right, Assemblymember Matt Haney, we appreciate your time here on Inside California Politics.
Thank you. I appreciate it.